Hi and welcome to the Open Tech Lab. So in today's video, we're going to be doing a quick little review and a teardown of this little device. This is the IBQ102 frequency counter. And I picked this up pretty cheap. I got it for less than $35 on AliExpress. And this device can measure any frequency from 10 Hz through to 2.6 GHz. Now, one of the reasons I'm interested in this device is that part of this whole project with the synthesizer in the video I did previously is that I'm interested in exploring what are some of the lowest cost methods of entry into the gigahertz bands and what are some of the lowest cost ways to assemble a poor man's toolkit for working at these frequencies. So I'm not expecting this device to have world-beating performance or anything, but the very ability to even detect the presence of a signal at all, to measure its frequency in any meaningful way at all, is something that's absolutely essential to be able to work at any frequency. And so this device kind of interests me because even though it won't be the best thing in the world, will it be something that can have some use to get someone going in that range as an entry-level thing? So in this video, we're going to test the device out and see how it works, and we'll do a little teardown and see what we can find out about its internals. So let's get started. Okay, so to begin with, I've got the whole contents of the package I received unpacked here, and you can see we've got a few different things. We've got a USB cable to charge the device up. We've got a USB wall transformer here. Now, this thing feels pretty darn light, which is not usually a good sign when it comes to build quality and safety of these Chinese power supplies. So I would suggest giving this thing a miss. Find a charger from a good brand that you trust. Any phone charger will work just fine. We've also got this little antenna here. Now, I don't know if this will come out on the video, but it says 400 to 470 megahertz. So that this is a UHF band antenna. And the idea is that you can just screw this into the top of the frequency counter here. And then this is useful for its kind of main use case that it's sold under, which is as a tester for a ham radio transmitter. So you can wave this thing up next to your radio and you just key it to transmit, and then you'll be able to check with how much power and at what frequency you're actually transmitting at, so you can have some certainty about what you're transmitting at rather than just guessing based on what the radio reports of itself. And then in addition to all this, we've got a lovely manual here, and it's in Chinese and it's got English, and I would imagine there will be some amusing Chinese translations in this thing. So let's have a closer look at the specifications here at the back of the manual. And as you can see, we've got two columns here, one for the IBQ101 and one for the IBQ102, which is the device I have. And we can compare the two. The main differences are the IBQ102 has a wider range of frequencies that it can receive from. So the 101 can measure from 50 megahertz through to 2.6 gigahertz. The 102 adds a different mode where it can receive from 10 hertz through to 100 megahertz. And when it's in that mode, it has 1 megaohm impedance rather than 50 ohm impedance. So this seems to be like a low frequency mode that you can use for measuring way down low in the frequency range. And the other difference between the IBQ102 and the 101 is that the 102 has a more accurate internal oscillator. So it's got a 5 parts per million accuracy oscillator versus 30 parts per million. Although these time bases are pretty low in terms of accuracy, that is certainly not world-beating performance, but that's just about what you might expect for a $35 device. So if we're getting sort of five and a half digits of accuracy from this device, I think we're doing pretty well. Now, just from holding this thing, I've got to say, it feels pretty solid. It feels pretty well put together. It's certainly doesn't rattle as I shake it, and it's got quite a bit of weight to it. That will be down to the number of batteries that it's got inside. They add quite a bit of weight, of course. And yeah, the whole thing, it feels like it must be quite well put together inside. We'll do a teardown in the middle and find out how it's actually put together. But yeah, I quite like holding this thing. It feels quite comfortable and it feels quite solid. So yeah, good job, guys. So to test out the IBQ-102, I've brought back my little synthesizer board, which I'll use to generate the input signal. This is the ADF4351 board, as I was showing in the previous video. And this board is capable of generating an input signal from about 35 MHz all the way up to 4.4 GHz. So certainly at the top range, this board is more than enough in terms of the frequencies that it will get us up to. Now, you might notice a little difference with the hardware setup I had in the previous video, because instead of having the Cypress FX2 as the USB microcontroller, instead now I've got this little STM32 board. And this little board is pretty cheap. I got it for $3.36 on AliExpress. And it's not much there, it's just a chip and a crystal. And it has the STM32F103. And I'm really glad to be using this processor. It's really nice programming these things. It's certainly a much nicer experience than programming the 8051 core in the Cypress FX2. And there's some really nice open source hardware support libraries that are available. Specifically libopencm3, which is what my firmware is written with. So the firmware that I've written is part of the PY-ADF435X project, which I was working on previously. And the important thing is that the firmware is completely compatible with the firmware for the FX2. So the same commands will work on either chip if you have the appropriate firmware installed. So that's quite nice. So the two boards are completely interchangeable. And given that they are, I prefer to use this board. I think it's a better choice for this application. And down the line, I'm planning to package this little contraption up into some kind of enclosure so that it will be a nice self-contained USB powered synthesizer in a box that's ready to go. So watch this space, we'll get there soon. Okay, so to give this thing a little test, I've set the synthesizer board to put out a 1 GHz tone. And as you can see, we're getting a reading here and a signal strength reading. And overall, I really like the user interface of this main screen. I think it's really well laid out. I think it looks great and they've used the space really well. So on the top left, we've got a G0.1S. This is the gate time of 0.1 seconds. And I'll talk a bit more about that in a minute. Battery indicator, flashing run to say we're capturing something and that we're not paused. Beautifully rendered text for the frequency reading value, and I really like this analog meter they've got for the signal strength. So overall, I think this whole layout's great. And then we've got a 3-button interface along the bottom. If we hold down F1, you can turn the backlight off if you want to save a bit of power, make the whole thing last a little bit longer. We can hold here, which basically pauses the sampling, and then you can save the captured frequency in a database that it stores inside itself. Okay, so let's have a little look at what we can find in the menu here. And the first option is this range option, which is a feature of the IBQ-102 only. And this allows us to select the frequency range mode that this device is set into. So we've got the higher frequency mode that can capture up to 2.6 GHz and the lower frequency mode that can capture up to 100 MHz. So if I just go and select the other one here and exit out, you might have heard a little click there as the internal relay switched over to the other input path. And now you can see we're not getting any reading at all because, of course, our 1 GHz tone is way out of band for the lower frequency mode. Next up, we've got this gate option here. Now, if I select that, you can see we've got three options: 1 second, 0.1 second, and 0.1 milliseconds. Now, when it comes to any frequency meter, there's an inherent trade-off between the precision of the reading and how much time is taken to take that reading. Now, a 0.1 millisecond reading would be really, really short and would give you much less precision, but it allows you to capture from any signal that's very, very brief in length, for example, and it also allows you to get a really high update rate in terms of the number of measurements that are being taken per second. And conversely, a 1 second would give you the greatest amount of precision, but the least responsiveness. So, let's select 1 second here. Now, if we go back to the main menu, you might notice that we've now got an extra decimal place in the meter reading here. And this is because now we've got 10 times more time that we're sampling the frequency over. So we've got just a little bit more precision in the reading. And for my use case as a sort of lab tool, this 1 second value is probably more suitable. Next up, we've got this auto hold button here. And this thing, I believe the purpose of this is so that you can say that when the input exceeds a certain threshold, then hold the reading. And I think this is useful if you're trying to use this thing to take measurements off an input signal that's quite transitory, because you wouldn't want to have a reading that's if you're updating the screen over and over and you get a single reading, and then by the time you've tried to read the value off the LCD, the value's disappeared entirely because the signal's gone away. So I think that's the purpose of this, is to allow that just to be displayed when it's first captured, which is quite a nice useful feature. Next up, we've got the auto save option, which would mean that it automatically saves, makes a save into the memory if it gets a successful capture one time. So we can go in here and we can just turn it on or off. Next up, we've got the view option, and this allows us to view any previously captured frequency readings. And you can see we can click through them here and see all the previous readings that we took. And I really like the way it's got this mock-up of the main screen here. It looks really good. And then after this, we've got this auto off feature, and this just means that the unit will power off after a period of usage, which of course will save your battery. And then what have we got next? LED. Yes, this little LED in the corner flashes when you're capturing a signal, so you can turn that one on and off in this menu. I like it on. I like the flashing LED. And then next up, we've got the calibration menu. So if we select this, in here, what we can do is select the calibration value. So if we had a known stable input, like an exact 1 gigahertz or an exact 10 megahertz, we can basically tweak the reading here until this device is calibrated against that input signal. And I will certainly be using that when I get my hands on a nice calibrated signal, although I don't have one to hand right now. So that's it for the menu, and that's it for the functions of the software here. And overall, I really like the way they've used the screen space. I think it looks great, and I really like this three button interface. I think they've done that really, really well. So certainly whoever thought this out, good job, big thumbs up. Okay, so let's do a little teardown and find out what we can find inside. So let's get started. Okay, so we're inside. So the first thing I notice is that these two little battery connections are directly soldered onto the battery clips here, which is not great in terms of reliability. These will likely drop off if you move these around too much, although hopefully that won't be a problem. Okay, so now we've got the screws out and the batteries removed, we can have a look at the construction of this thing. And as you can see, it is a dual board construction. So we've got two boards here, one board here which has the LCD and the main logic on it, and then we seem to have an RF front end board on the top here. So let's break these up and look at them one by one. So let's begin by having a look at the RF board. And as you can see, we've got the SMA connector here, and this feeds straight into the relay. Now this relay is used to select between the two ranges. There are two different input paths, one for the 2.6 gigahertz path and one for the 100 megahertz mode. And as you can see, for the 2.6 gigahertz path, the signal progresses around this side through some filters and capacitors, passives and so on. And then we have here what looks like a little amplifier FET. And I think this is being used to boost the signal up so that we've got enough enough amplitude to be able to take a measurement. And then the signal makes its way into this little device here. This is an MB506. It's a Fujitsu divider prescaler, and it can be switched and it will divide your signal's frequency in 64 or 128 or by 256. This thing is basically like a counter. And so the idea is that if you've got a signal that's coming in the gigahertz range, this thing will divide it down by, you know, 128 or something to get that frequency down to a level where it's actually countable by, you know, a more normal type of chip down the line. And then the signal just makes its way out down into this little header here, where it goes down to the logic board. Now, on the other side of the board, if we have a look here, it's quite interesting the way they've built this. They've got a sort of daughter PCB module here that's soldered onto the RF board. So I really don't know why they had this componentry on a separate PCB here. I don't know why they didn't just put all this componentry straight down on the board. It seems a bit weird to me. Now, I've been trying to figure out exactly what all this does, and I'm not exactly sure. But it's some of this, I think, is to do with the lower frequency path, the 100 megahertz path. And I think also some of this is to do with the power detection circuitry. But what's slightly puzzling me is that in the middle here, we've got an MC10H116, which is an on-semiconductor triple line receiver. So I don't really know why they need a line receiver, and I don't know why they need a triple line receiver here. So I haven't exactly figured out what all this stuff is all about. But anyway, this is all wired up to the headers, and this then heads down to the logic board. Okay, so let's have a look at the main logic board. And as you can see, there are a few things here. First of all, we've got this device. This is an STM32F103. Which is an ARM microcontroller by the ST Microelectronics Company. And of course, this will be running all the menus and the user interface, and all the brains of this system will be in the software that's running on this microcontroller. Then in the middle here, we've got a temperature compensated crystal oscillator by the Toyocom company. And this is a TCXO that makes a 13 megahertz output frequency. So this is the frequency reference that's being used to deliver the reference against which the counting is going to be performed. And then over here we've got this Altera Max 2 CPLD, which is a programmable logic device, and this device will have been programmed to contain the frequency counting functionality that this device needs, and it will have all the gating, and basically the meat of this frequency counter is right here. And this is just going to be taking in the signal that's coming in from the RF board upstairs over the top through these board-to-board connectors. And then on the other side here, you can see there isn't much. We've got a bit of power supply circuitry. We've got a battery charging chip here, which is responsible for charging up the lithium batteries. And we've got a DC-DC converter controller here in the middle. We've got some buttons, push buttons, and of course we've got the main LCD and the blinking LED. And that's about all we have for this system. Now, there's just one other thing I'd like to point out, and that is that they have made this device really easy to reprogram if you want to hack on this device in any way. So we've got the pins here for the single wire debug, which can be used to attach a debugger to the STM32, and it can be used to reprogram the firmware inside this device. And they've also got the pins here for the JTAG header, which is attached to the Altera Max 2 CPLD. So if you're thinking of hacking this device in any way, if you'd like to write a custom firmware for it, maybe you'd like to write an open source firmware that has more features or whatever, this device has certainly made it reasonably easy to go ahead and replace the firmware inside, which is really good news. Okay, so I've got the unit back in one piece, and so now I'd like to do some tests to find out how well it performs. So to begin with, I want to test out the high frequency mode. And with that mode, it claims it can take measurements on any input signal from 50 megahertz through to 2.6 gigahertz. So to test this thing out, I've attached the frequency counter to the synthesizer, and we'll be able to feed in tones of various frequencies, and we'll be able to see how well the frequency counter does as we go towards the limits. So to begin with, let's test out the upper limits of this device, and according to the specification, it should be able to receive a 2.6 gigahertz signal, and that's what I'm feeding in. And as you can see, we're getting a good reading here, nice and solid, minus any calibration issues. Now, if I add 100 megahertz to the input signal, set it to 2.7 gigahertz, you can see that we're still getting a reasonable reading, even 100 megahertz over spec here, which is pretty good, although the signal strength has fallen away a little bit. So now if I add another 50 megahertz, so we're now at 2.75 gigahertz, 150 megahertz above spec, now you can see that the whole thing has rather fallen apart, and we're not getting anything close to being precise, and the value's jumping all over. And one of the problems is that the unit doesn't know that it's got an out-of-spec reading, so you can't really know that this reading is invalid, other than that you know something about the signal that's being fed in. But all the same, it's great that we're getting this 100 megahertz or so of over-spec performance. So now let's test the bottom boundary of the high frequency range. So I've set the synthesizer to put out a 50 megahertz tone. And as you can see, we're getting a really good reading at that frequency. So now if I set the synthesizer to 33 megahertz, you can see that we're still getting a good reading. And that is quite a bit out of spec for that high frequency mode. So even though it says it's limited only down to 50 megahertz, it seems to be able to reach quite a bit lower. So to test this thing at lower frequencies, I've attached it to my MHS5200A signal generator. And this is another piece of equipment from AliExpress. I picked it up for about $60. And if you're interested in finding out more about it, I recommend you check out the videos on DevTTYS0's channel. He did a whole load of testing and experiments and teardowns and mods. So I'll link his videos in the show notes if you're interested in finding out more. Anyway, as you can see, I've got the signal generator putting out a 500 kilohertz tone, and I'm still in the high frequency mode of the frequency counter, so I should only be able to receive down to 50 megahertz according to the specification. But you can see here we're receiving half a megahertz, which is pretty cool. And at this limit, you can see that if we go down to 400 kilohertz here, the thing begins to fall apart. And if you go down even lower, if I take it down to 300 kilohertz, it begins to fall apart more and more. But still, this is so far out of the specification for that upper mode. It's pretty impressive. And of course, some people will only have the IBQ101, which doesn't have a dedicated low frequency mode. But even without that, it seems to be able to capture signals quite happily down to 500 kilohertz and beyond. So if you've only got the 101, there's probably quite a bit of untapped potential beyond the official specification there. Now, in the low frequency range, the specification claims that the unit can receive frequencies down to 10 hertz. But in my testing, I found that I can't get it to go much below 40 hertz, and only if I have the wave shape set to be a square wave. So if I set it to a sine wave here, you can see the frequency reading goes off onto some other value. I don't know if that's because it's picking up on some aliasing that's coming out of the signal generator or not, but it seems a lot happier if I put in a square wave like this, and then we'll get a reasonable reading. And I've set the gating time to 1 second here. And if I try and reduce the frequency a little, take it down to 30 hertz, let's see if we get a good reading. Yeah, you see it's not doing very well, and it's, yeah, the value's jumping all over the place, and it's not anywhere near close to being correct. So in all the testing of the low frequency mode I've done so far, I found it to be a little bit unreliable, and I'm a little bit disappointed by it, and I'm not sure that I'd completely trust it to give me an accurate reading. But, you know, it's a nice to have feature and it might come in handy sometime. Okay, so now I want to return to the high frequency mode of the frequency counter, and I want to do some sensitivity tests. And so to do that, I'm going to hook it back up to the synthesizer, and then I'm going to insert a certain number of these RF attenuators in the signal pathway so that we can weaken the signal by a certain number of decibels. And by doing this, we'll be able to weaken and weaken the signal that comes into it by a known amount, and then we'll work out to what extent the frequency counter can hang on to the reading as the input becomes weaker and weaker. Now, before we move on, I just want to say a little bit about RF attenuators. And for the ones that don't know, an RF attenuator is in principle a very simple thing. All it does is it takes in an RF signal at one voltage amplitude, at one power, and it dissipates some of that power and feeds it out at a reduced voltage amplitude, at a reduced power. And the amount of attenuation is measured in decibels. So an attenuator can be implemented with a simple network of resistors, which sounds pretty easy to build, but in practice it's very hard to make an attenuator that is perfectly consistent and reliable. So these attenuators claim that they'll give you the exact number of decibels of attenuation that you expect through the whole bandwidth of their operation, all the way from DC to 6 GHz, which is quite a challenging thing to achieve. And more than that, it must have a completely consistent impedance across that range. So it must have a 50 ohms impedance, and it mustn't have any inductance or resonances that kick in at certain frequencies. And more than this, it must also have stability across various ranges of temperature of operation. So the ambient temperature of the environment might change by quite a range of temperatures. And more than this, it's quite possible that someone might feed in quite a powerful RF signal, in which case the RF attenuator would have to dissipate a significant amount of power, which would cause it to heat up. And even when this happens, it must still have a completely consistent attenuation and performance. And so as a result of this, a branded RF attenuator is not a cheap thing. So for example, Minicircuits is a big name in the industry, and they sell their attenuators for about $13.99 a pop. And to make measurements with RF attenuators, you really need a complete kit of different values. So in this collection here, I've got 30s, 20s, 10s, 5s, 3s, 2s and 1s. So you can add them up and get the exact amount of attenuation that you expect. So if you buy a kit of attenuators from a branded supplier, it can become very, very expensive. Now, this kit of attenuators I bought on eBay from a Chinese seller, and he sold them to me for $3.98 each, plus about $5 each for shipping. But I was able to negotiate with the guy to buy the whole kit under a reduced shipping price, so it was like $10 or so to get the whole kit shipped. So in the end, this is about as cheap as I could possibly expect to be able to get a kit of attenuators for, and I really don't know how well they perform as compared to a proper branded product. But for my needs, I'm interested in having an entry-level kit here, and I'm not exactly sure how well they really perform. I haven't got a VNA that I can test them out with, but if they're good enough for me to do some simple measurements with, that's all I need. So to begin with, I've set up the frequency counter with a signal going in at 1 GHz, and there's no attenuation in the signal path, and we're reading a signal strength of -1.5 dBm. Now, I'll just mention this because the unit dBm is not decibel meters, it's decibels relative to a milliwatt. So if you have 0 dBm, you have exactly 1 milliwatt of RF power being transferred, and if you have 3 dBm, then you have 2 milliwatts, and if you have 6, you have 4, and if you have 10 dBm, you have 10 milliwatts being transferred, and so on. So this is receiving -1.5 dBm, which is slightly weird because I would expect to read +5 dBm because that's what the synthesizer is configured to transmit at. So I'm not sure where I'm losing 6.5 dBm, which is of course a factor of just over 4 in power loss. So something a bit odd is going on here. So the synthesizer is still configured to put out a 1 GHz tone, but this time I've been adding attenuators to the signal path. And I found that anything over 30 decibels causes the frequency counter to lose lock on the signal. So now I've just got 30 decibels of attenuation in the signal path here. And as you can see, the signal strength has dropped away by a corresponding 30 decibels, which is good. Now, the input signal strength of -31.5 dBm is it's not particularly low signal strength in terms of a radio receiver. A typical radio receiver might be able to receive down to -95 or 100 or -105 dBm. But for an instrument like a frequency counter, a minimum input signal strength of -31.5 dBm is pretty reasonable, really. That is one part in 1,000 compared to the full power signal I was feeding in just now. So now I want to test it at other frequencies. So I've set the input frequency to 50 MHz, as you can see here, and I found that at this frequency I could add an extra 10 decibels of attenuation in here. So it seems a lot more sensitive as you head towards that lower frequency bound. So now I've set the synthesizer to the upper limit at 2.6 GHz, and I found that at this frequency, the sensitivity of the frequency counter is much, much less. I found that anything more than 13 decibels of attenuation causes it to lose hold of the signal. And so there seems to be a drop-off as you go towards higher and higher frequencies with this thing, which I suppose isn't really a surprise. Now, if you're doing tests with attenuators, you have to be very careful to make sure that you don't end up with misleading results, because in a typical radio system, over the air, the transmission might incur 90 or 100 dB of attenuation, and a radio receiver might be able to receive down to minus 95 or 100 plus dBm, as I say. And therefore, the amounts of attenuation that you typically need in your cabling is huge. I mean, 90 dB of attenuation is equivalent to light breathing or leaves rustling in comparison to a pneumatic drill, to a jackhammer. And therefore, you can very easily end up leaking signal around your attenuation path. So, for example, in this setup, if we had 90 dB of attenuation here, probably the dominant amount of transmission between the synthesizer and the receiver would be the signal radiating off the synthesizer here, traveling over the air through the plastic shell and onto the board traces inside here. And therefore, if you're doing an experiment of this kind where you need a really high level of attenuation to simulate a real-world radio system, you need to be very careful about your setup. Typically, both ends will need to be in sealed metal enclosures, which are sealed in with RF gaskets, and you will probably want to spread them apart in your lab space by a few meters distance. So you'll want to get some SMA cables that are long enough to reach from one end to the other. And then you probably want to get your attenuators distributed evenly along breaks in the cabling. So last time I did an experiment like this with a real RF system, we had two metal boxes, one at each end, and then we had a whole sequence of 1 meter long SMA cables punctuated by an attenuator along the length. And we found that if we did anything less than this, that we'd end up with misleading results, because of course the signal would be jumping around the attenuators through the air rather than being absorbed by the attenuators. So you just need to be careful that you're getting as weak a signal going into the receiver as you think you are. But in this case, the amounts of attenuation that we're applying here are so minimal that this kind of thing doesn't really become a significant factor. Okay, so now for a bit of an experiment. So I've come upstairs, and as you can see, I've attached an antenna to the frequency counter. This is a cellular antenna, and of course it's tuned to receive various bands that are used in the various generations of GSM and LTE and so on. Now what I want to do is try and see if we can capture the transmit frequency that my phone uses. Now of course the signal that we'll receive from the base station, you know, however many miles away it is, will be way too weak for the frequency counter to pick it up. But it will be able to pick up transmissions that are sent from my phone. So we're going to see if we can figure out what frequency the uplink from my phone is transmitting on. Now the thing about cellular protocols when it comes to the uplink is that they use a packet-based protocol. And so the RF transmission is inherently bursty. So the phone will be transmitting short bursts of power separated by radio silence. And because of this, it's going to be quite difficult to capture the signal and get a good reading, because we don't have a continuous signal coming in. All we have is a series of short bursts. And so to try and deal with this issue, I've set up the frequency counter in the best way that we can to try and get a good reading. I've set the gating period to this 0.1 milliseconds value, which is the shortest sampling period that this device will allow you to sample with. And of course, this gives you the least precision. But even if we could get some reading at all, that will be helpful, because we can use other tools to drill down and find the signal we're looking for. And I've also gone ahead and set up the auto hold feature. And as I showed earlier, the idea of this feature is that if it detects a certain amount of power inside the gating period, then it will hold the reading on the screen rather than erasing it and replacing it with a new reading. Because otherwise we'll get a reading and it will vanish from the screen before we get a chance to read it. So in order to test this thing out, I've installed this advert-infested speed testing app on the smartphone. And this app has three phases. First, it does a ping test where it tries to measure the ping interval to a test server. It does a download test where it tries to download as much data as fast as possible. And it does an upload test where it tries to upload as much data from the phone as fast as possible. Now, when it comes to the ping test and the download test, the phone is not going to be sending long packets, because it's either going to be sending pings or very brief acknowledgement packets to the download stream. So on that basis, we're probably not going to be able to see very much being captured on the frequency counter. But when the upload test kicks in, there will be big long packets being sent, sending up that payload that's going up to the speed testing server. So now let's go ahead and run the test and see what happens. So we're testing the ping, and as you can see, we've got some very transitory readings here. 18 something is appearing periodically. There's the download test getting a better reading, but still quite transitory. Okay, and now the upload testing is going to kick in, and there you go. We've got a long enough burst for the frequency counter to lock on and hold, and it's giving me a reading of 1806 megahertz. Now I'm just rerunning the test here, and as you can see, the reading we're getting is jumping around all over the place, and this time I've disabled the auto hold feature, and you can see it's jumping between a few values. Now I'm not sure if this is an artifact of the frequency counter itself and how the gating period interacts with the bursts of the packets, or if this is more related to the 4G LTE and how it hops between different transmit channels. Now I think one improvement I'd like to have is more advanced triggering functionality, so you can do a power detect trigger off short packets. So I don't know if this is something that could be added with a simple firmware change, or if it would need a change to the hardware to allow that to be possible. So to get a bit more detail on this phenomenon with bursty signals, I've set the synthesizer with a little script, and the script sets the synthesizer at 1 GHz for 0.1 of a second, and then it switches it off for 0.1 of a second. So you end up with a 50% duty cycle between a 1 GHz tone and no tone at all. Now if we look at the measured frequency here, and I've got the gating time set to 1 second, you can see that it's measuring at 500 megahertz, which is kind of truthful because in a second, of course, the frequency counter will receive about 500 million cycles of frequency signal coming in. So now I've changed the gating period to 0.1 milliseconds, and now you can see we're getting a truthful reading of that 1 GHz tone half the time, and the other half the time we're getting some random reading when the signal isn't there. So all of this suggests to me that you have to be very careful how you sample bursty data with this thing, because, well, unless the gating period completely falls within the period that the transmitter is transmitting for, then you'll get some inaccurate reading where half the gate is filled with an actual signal and half of it is filled with silence, which leads to a garbage reading. Now, one of the things I found configuring this thing is that whatever I did with the auto hold feature, I couldn't get it to hold on to this 1 GHz tone, because I'd really like it to trigger off the tone when it's received, and then you could get an accurate reading only when there's a signal present. But I couldn't find a way of getting this device to function that way. So the triggering seems to be a real problem with this device for bursty signals. I wouldn't be particularly trusting of any bursty signal, and I certainly don't really trust the results from that test with the cellular phone. Now, of course, the unit has a USB port on the side for the purposes of charging the battery. And also, the microcontroller, the STM32, has USB support built into it, which got me wondering if the device would output the readings over USB. And if this was the case, although it's not mentioned in the manual at all, maybe it would be possible to take the readings off the device and feed it into a PC. And Sigrox supports all kinds of data loggers, so it would be really cool to do an integration with the IBQ102 and Sigrox. But unfortunately, I discovered that although the hardware does support doing this, the firmware doesn't have this feature implemented at the current time. But although the result's negative, I will show you the process I went through to make this determination, because there are one or two interesting things we can find out about the device's USB interface. So let's have a look at the output of LSUSB, and as you can see here, we've got a complete list of every USB device connected to my PC, and the relevant item is this device, 6543001, and the reason there's no text here is because they've camped out on some unallocated vendor code, and so the hardware database can't give any information about this device. Now, if we want to drill down in a bit more detail on this device, we can put LSUSB-D6543001-V, and this will give us a complete list of the various descriptors that the device exposes. So overarching everything, we have the device descriptor, which defines a single configuration descriptor. This is all very standard. And then within that, a single interface is defined. Now, the class of this interface is a human interface device. And within the USB specification, the human interface device spec, or HID spec, refers to devices like mice and keyboards, but it also can encompass all kinds of exotic and unknown devices and any kind of human interface device you can really imagine can be exposed as a HID device. Now, oftentimes many test instruments will expose themselves as human interface devices. And the reason they do this is that it makes things significantly easier to handle on Windows, because with a HID device, you can talk to it from Windows user space without needing to write any drivers. And so many devices, including some test instruments that have very low needs in terms of rate of data transfer, will expose themselves of some kind of mystery unknown human interface device, which will be something that only the vendor control software will be able to understand. But it works quite nicely in the end, because no driver writing is involved. So this, when I first saw it, looked pretty promising in terms of getting some kind of data logging from the IBQ 102. And within this interface descriptor, we have some HID specific information, and then we have a couple of endpoints being defined, all standard stuff. So given that this device exposes itself as a HID device, we can use the USB HID dump tool by Nikolai Kondrashov, and it's open source and it's available on GitHub. We can use that tool to see if it transfers any messages. And I've got it compiled locally here, so I'll just run it up. Source USB HID dump, and we'll specify the device ID 6543 treble 01, and we'll specify that we want to get every record. Now, in the output here, you can see we've got some hexadecimal bytes. This is the human interface device descriptor bytes. And now the tool is waiting to see if it will receive any messages from the IBQ 102. And the IBQ 102 is running right now with gigahertz tone being fed into it. But unfortunately, no matter what I do, I can never get it to transfer any messages. So it looks like it never actually does use this interface to transfer any relevant information. Now, one thing we can do with the output from USB HID dump is we can decode the meaning of the hexadecimal bytes. So what we'll do here is we'll take this off the end and we'll pipe the output into grep-v, and we'll filter out all the lines with colons in them. And then we'll do xxd-r-p, and this will convert the hexadecimal characters back into binary data. And then we'll run it into this HID-RD tool, which is also written by Nikolai Kondrashov, and it's also on his GitHub profile, and we'll output the spec here. There we go, and we've got a bit of information about this device, and it seems to come up as some kind of pointing device which has two axes, so it almost exposes itself as some kind of mouse or something. So I'm not sure what's going on there. So what exactly are we seeing here? Well, the device never sends any data through the human interface device interface, so we can't use it as a data logger. Now, you might wonder why they would ever bother exposing a human interface device. And there are two things that come to mind. Maybe it's an unfinished feature that they plan to add later, or maybe they just do it to keep the host PC happy. So in the interface, they specify that they want to be allowed 100 milliamps of current. And they might be doing this just to make sure that the power supply doesn't get cut off when the device is charging the battery. I really don't know, but I would really love it if this device could improve in this area so that we could actually do data logging through this interface. So that just about wraps it up for my little review of this device, and I think this device would be quite useful for anyone who needs an entry-level frequency counter. It's very low cost and it can measure frequencies up into the gigahertz range, which is a really, really powerful thing to have available. And of course, the device isn't perfect. There are one or two areas where I think it could be improved, for example, in the area of triggering, and it would be nice if it could do data logging over USB, and perhaps some of these things could be improved through changes to the firmware. So I wonder if the manufacturer will make changes to the firmware as time goes along. And also, if anyone's looking for a nice open source firmware project, I should think that this device might be quite an interesting platform to hack on and produce some aftermarket firmware for. So that's about it for our video today. Thank you very much for watching, and if you enjoyed it, give it a big thumbs up and subscribe, and hopefully I'll see you next time on the Open Tech Lab.